analysis of transition metal oxide. Harold and I have a couple of things common in our careers. The career has, we can both claim to be the academic grandson of Hugh Taylor by our common study with Robert Burwell in Northwestern. We also both moved from chemistry degrees in the chemical engineering department, but there are distinct differences in both areas. In the case of the chemical engineering teaching, Harold cheated by getting an undergraduate degree in chemical engineering at Wisconsin in 1971, and I had to learn from my students as I was teaching it. He cheated very well because he got through with his degree in 3 years, and that was rather a particular distinction in Burwell's laboratory, but then he turned around and mollified Robert by staying on as a postdoctor for one more year, so Burwell got his 4 years after all. After getting his degree at Northwestern, he had a short stint at DuPont, and then returned to Northwestern as assistant professor of chemical engineering in 1976, and moved up to the ranks over a period of 10 years, and assumed the chairman of the Department of Chemical Engineering in 1986. And he is currently chairman of chemical engineering, professor of chemical engineering and chemistry at Northwestern. His early work started out in metal catalysis, but he very quickly moved into oxide. Early contributions were made in theoretical work, our understanding of surface diffusion, bonding to oxide surface, particularly predictions, theoretical predictions of the acid-base properties of mixed oxide. He was one of the first to apply modern surface science techniques to oxide surfaces, and also the metals, particularly in the oxide surfaces. Do we find a distinction from what others were doing? His most outstanding work is in oxidative dehydrogenation. This was initiated with the study of dehydrogenation of butanes over oxides. He's currently continuing that work in oxidative dehydrogenation of propane over magnesium bands. Much of this experience he summarized for us in a recent book, Transition Metal Oxide to Surface Chemistry and Catalysis, and this morning he's going to give his award address, which is entitled Alphane Oxidation over Modified Vanadium Oxide Catalyst. Harold?
Thank you, Gary. Ladies and gentlemen, it's indeed a great honor for me to be a recipient of this prestigious Emmett Award. And thinking about it, it's quite clear to me that I could not have done much of what I have done without the help of a lot of people. And for that, I'd like to acknowledge that, the help by listing their names right at the first slide. By the way, well, I listed up here are the colleagues that I've been working with, as well as co-workers and students. As I said, without the contribution of all these people, there's no way I could have done what I've done. Of all these people, there are two that I'd like to mention specifically. One is Robert Burwell, many of you know him quite well. And for the last 20 years, he has been a mentor, a colleague, a critic, and a source of inspiration and discussion. And I really enjoy my association with him. And the other one also has been helping me for the last 20 years in my professional career is Dr. Nathan Kong here. She also has been a constant source of discussion and critic for my work. What I'd like to talk about today is work based on the activity in the last 4 or 5 years, mainly in the activation of alkanes over modified vanadium oxide catalysts. The talk has been broken down into 3 different parts. The first part is to discuss the effect of structural modification on some of the vanadium catalysts in the oxidative dehydrogenation of alkanes. This serves as an introduction, so to speak, to some of the unusual observations that we have made. part of it is on that modification, that modification, and part of it deals with an observation which we don't fully understand between the rates of algae consumption and oxygen consumption over some of these catalysts. And the work that we're summarizing will be those that are done on these three different oxide catalysts. And finally, this observation of the unexpected relationship led us into looking at what could be some of the consequences of this relationship, which then resulted in looking into what is meant by some of the observed centurion kinetic isotope effect. Is it truly a measure of rate limiting step, or do we have to modify it under certain conditions? So the first part of the talk then is to talk about our work on oxidative dehydrogenation of alkanes. Some of you have heard that in the last 2 days that alkane perhaps, or the activation of alkane perhaps, could be one important area of research in the near future. And we've been looking at that. Particularly, our emphasis has been looking at the conversion of alkanes into certain materials for other chemicals, as chemicals themselves. But to do so, some of the ways that people are trying to work to do is to introduce functional groups of various kinds into the alkane. Some people may also try to isolate alkanes to the branch of cyclic hydrocarbons. Some people are also trying to couple smaller alkanes into larger molecules, but particularly coupling of methane is a very active area of research. We have not been working with methane at all. Our emphasis has been on the C2, C3, C4 type of alkanes. In fact, our work has been mostly along the line of introduction of functional groups. For that, there are different ways one can introduce functional groups. We can introduce unsaturated carbon-carbon bonds. In essence, that is the hydrogenation of alkenes to alkenes, dienes, and aromatics. One can add oxygen atoms into the molecule to form alcohol, aldehydes, acids, or anhydrides and the like. And also other heteroatoms can be added, the formation of amines, amines, nitriles, chlorohydrocarbons are examples of those. Work in our laboratories has been mainly the reaction of alkane with oxygen, so the work falls into the first two categories. Some of our work now deals with the second aspect, but most of our earlier work, which is what I've been talking about, deals with the dehydrogenation work of alkane. Let me take an example of what I mean here. If I look at the reaction of butane with oxygen, one can in principle write down some of the possible reaction pathways in this scheme here. So butane can be oxidated with dehydrogenated to form butene, which can then be further oxidized to form butadiene. Can you focus it a little bit, please? To butadiene, and a further reaction perhaps can be such that it adds oxygen to the butadiene to form furan, add more oxygen to form maleic anhydride, and finally, eventually, can form other products leading to carbon dioxide. Of course, for the dehydrogenation reaction, we are talking about then the formation of the first two products. Well, when we started the work, we asked the question, if butenes or alkenes and dienes are the products that we would like to have, what might be the desirable properties of the catalyst? So we formulated the following postulates. We said that in order to observe the desired product, we would like to see, like them to have a very short surface resistance time. Now, the alkenes and the dienes, they contain the functional group, which are the carbon-carbon double bonds. And one can think of these carbon-carbon double bonds as the electron-rich region of the molecule. Well, if that's the case, the bonding or the absorption of these molecules would probably be mostly through the carbon-carbon double bonds. If you want these molecules to have a short residence time, this desired product for the short residence time, perhaps we would prefer oxide to have, but they have electron-rich active sites. In essence, these are the Lewis-based type of oxides, or oxides containing Lewis-based active sites. So for that, we would like to choose a basic oxide as our catalyst to try. Well, now, having a short surface resistance time is not the only criteria. Perhaps Perhaps we would also like the catalyst to have rather low reactivity. That is, the lattice oxygen, which perhaps is believed to be the oxygen that's added to the, let's say, the carbon-carbon double bonds. We would like those lattice oxygen to have low reactivity toward these adsorbed products. For the lattice oxygen to react with the products, we are talking about removing the lattice oxygen from the solid, and in doing so, we are talking about then reducing the solid. So perhaps when we use the oxide reducibility as a good measure as to how reactive are the lattice oxygen, well, the reducibility of the oxide is essentially the reducibility of the cation. Now, in addition to looking at just the reducibility of the cation as a whole, we actually are talking about the reducibility at the local environment of the active site. So with these two postulates, we then try to formulate what are maybe some of the possible selective catalysts for this reaction. And our initial work starts off with choosing magnesium oxide as a basic oxide. And it's quite well known in the literature that basically the magnesium oxide is relatively inactive for the oxidation of butane. Then we said that maybe we need to have some reactive oxygen, although not very reactive lattice oxygen, but somewhat reactive oxygen. Then we thought that vanadium oxide may be a good component to add to the magnesium oxide. Vanadium oxide is known to be very reactive in the reaction of butane, and that is published at that time, that the catalyst would simply burn butane in the carbon dioxide, which is non-selective. Our thought is that by mixing these two together, we may be able to modify the vanadium oxide by the magnesium oxide, and also vice versa modify the vanadium oxide by magnesium oxide. And this is a summary of some of the results. And here I'm showing you the selectivity for dehydrogenation versus the weight percent of vanadium oxide in the mixture of vanadium magnesium oxide. The reaction conditions are shown here. It's a mixture of butane, oxygen, and helium, and the reaction is around 500 to 540 degrees. It turns out that what I showed you here is not very dependent on the temperature over this range. We see that pure magnesium oxide, as I said earlier, is both not very reactive and not very selective. Pure vanadium oxide also is not very selective. Once we have a mixture of these two in the mixed oxide, the selectivity for dehydrogenation significantly increased. The next step in our work was then to try to understand exactly what is the active phase in this vanadium magnesium oxide. I will not be showing you the detail of our characterization, rather I will show you the summary of it. We characterized these mixed oxides with various conventional techniques, such as X-ray diffraction, surface compositional analysis with XPS or J, and infrared spectroscopy. And all of this shows that the increase in activity and selectivity correlates very well with the appearance of this particular phase, magnesium oxide. At that point, we start asking the question, why is it that magnesium oxovanadate is a much better catalyst than vanadium oxide itself? We thought that then maybe looking at the structure of the oxide would give us a clue. By so doing, we said that we found that there is indeed a difference in the structural bonding of the oxygen in the vanadium oxide versus magnesium oxovanadate. In particular, a vanadium oxide contains this vanadium oxygen vanadium bridging bond, as well as the vanadium double bond or terminal vanadium oxygen there. Our thinking is that perhaps this bridging bond is more involved in our reaction and we should focus on it. Whereas in this magnesium oxovanadate, that all the oxygen are bonded between the magnesium and the vanadium. A vanadium is reducible, whereas magnesium is not reducible. This type of bonding perhaps could then reduce the reactivity of the lattice oxygen toward the adsorbed alkene. Let me show you some of the crystallographic pictures of this magnesium oxovanadate to give you an idea of what I mean by bridge bonding of the magnesium oxygen vanadium. Here's a model of the magnesium oxovanadate. All the red circles are oxygen ions. The white ones are the magnesium, and all and the yellow ones are the vanadium. With some imagination, maybe you can see that there is no vanadium-oxygen-vanadium bridging bonds. All the oxygens are bridged between the magnesium and the vanadium. Perhaps a little bit clearer picture is of this projection diagram, also for this particular compound, magnesium orthobenedate. These are the magnesium O6 groups, whereas the triangles are the projections of the vanadium oxygen tetrahedron. You can see then that the vanadium O4 tetrahedron are isolated from each other. Confirming what I just said, that there is the absence of vanadium oxygen vanadium bond. Well, if our thinking is indeed correct, that the absence of vanadium oxygen vanadium is the reason for the high selectivity for this magnesium orthobenedate, we are essentially talking about the fact that the metal cation that bridges the oxygen determines its reactivity. And I said earlier that the reaction involves removal of the oxygen from the lattice, so we can postulate or extend our postulation saying that if we modify the catalyst by replacing the magnesium with other cations, we should see a corresponding change in the selectivity as we change the reducibility of this cation. So there are many different cations when they substitute into this structure, and some of those are listed in this diagram. Using the aqueous reduction potential as a good measure of the reducibility of the cation in the lattice, magnesium then is the least reducible in this series, whereas vanadium is the most reducible. So what we have done is that we have been comparing the two extremes of the possibilities. If our thinking is correct, then if we substitute the magnesium by this series of cations, what you see a corresponding change in the selectivity because the reduction potential changes in this particular manner. We've done that. We made some of these oxides. All of them are pure compounds of the orthobenedate structure. And what I've brought out here is the selectivity for dehydrogenation of butane right under these similar conditions as the one I show you, as a function of the reduction potential of the cation that we put into the structure. And all of these are compared at the same conversion, so that these are indeed just a true measure of the differences in selectivity. Perhaps you may agree with me that there's a rough correlation between the selectivity of the hydrogenation and the reduction potential of the cation, suggesting that our thinking has some truth to it. The only exception is aluminum. We are still trying to understand if there are other factors involved in this particular data point. Well, up to this point, I have been talking about the importance of this reduction of this group, maybe a metal oxygen metal bridging group, in the sense of removing the lattice oxygen, reducing the cation in the meantime. And in the last slide, I show you a crude measure of this reducibility by looking at the reduction potential of the aqueous cation. Perhaps another way to measure the reactivity of the oxygen in this particular manner is to look at the thermodynamic properties of it, in essence, the heat of removal of the oxygen. Well, it's easier for us to measure actually the heat of reoxidation, the reverse reaction, and this is some of the work that we've done. What we've done, however, is not to measure the heat of reduction of the series of orthobenedate yet. Rather, we've been looking at the heat of reoxidation of some supported vanadium oxide. Our thinking is as such. If this indeed is an important parameter in the determining the selectivity or the activity of a catalyst, this type of bonding strength not only should depend on the nature of the cation and the structure, not only depend on the nature of the cation, it should also depend on the structure. And one way to change the structure will be to support the oxide one another support. In essence, I'm saying that the heat of oxidation, using it as a measure of the metal oxygen bond strength, should be a function of the nature of the surface species, which in turn depends on the support that one uses, the loading of the material, and the preparation method as well as the treatment. Finally, it's also not surprising to perhaps people involved in the field that one would expect that to be a function of the degree of reduction as well. What I will show you then next is a slight deviation from the work of the oxidative dehydrogenation. Rather than show you our attempt to measure the heat of reduction, heat of reoxidation, or the metal oxygen bond strength for some supported vanadium oxide. Well, the choice of the vanadium oxide is a supported vanadium oxide is because of the fact that it's now relatively well accepted that a small amount of vanadium and supports exists in a number of different structures. And some of them exist in the so-called isolated vanadium species as such. Some of them might form a network, and on this network there could be different types of oxygen species. Some may be a terminal oxygen as such, some may be bridging oxygen as such. However, the bond strength and the bond length and the ideal structure could very well depend on the structure of the substrate. So titanium, silica, alumina may give you very different properties of this alpha vanadium on top of it. The work that we've been doing has been mainly on the support of vanadium on alumina. It has been shown in the literature that if a study, let's say, selective oxidation of toluene to form benzaldehyde over supported vanadium on alumina, the selectivity as well as the activity of this reaction depends on the vanadium loading. In essence, both the selectivity and the activity increases with increasing loading from very low to about, let's say, around 8, a number of 8 here corresponds to roughly 1 monolayer coverage of vanadium. Perhaps then, if our thinking is correct along this direction, the change here should correspond to a change in the reactivity of the lattice oxygen or the metal oxygen bond strain. So we take this a series of catalysts of this type from zero, from a very low monolayer vanadium up to close to a 1 monolayer vanadium and measure then the metal oxygen bond strain by measuring the heat of reoxidation of these catalysts. Well, the way we do the experiment is that we take a vanadium supported alumina, reduce it to roughly an equivalent of converting all vanadium 5 plus into all vanadium 4 plus ions. And then we expose the catalyst to a small dose of oxygen and measure then the heat of the reoxidation. And we repeat the doses of oxygen until all the oxide is reoxidized. Well, in addition to measuring the heat of reoxidation, we could also measure the kinetics to a certain extent of reoxidation by measuring the pressure drop of the gas-based oxygen as the reaction proceeds. And these are some of the data here. The phi represents the degree of reduction of the catalyst. So when we started off our reaction, the degree of reduction is 0.4, that is, there is 0.4 oxygen removed per vanadium ion. When it's 0.5, all the vanadium will be in vanadium 4 plus, or the average 4 plus. So for this particular sample, when we expose it to oxygen, it picks up oxygen very rapidly. And then the sample is oxidized to a small extent. And that rapid pickup of oxygen continues, but then it slows down as the catalyst starts to be oxidized further and further. As simultaneously, as I said, we could measure the heat of reoxidation, and these are some of the summary of the results. What I show you here is the heat of reoxidation per mole of oxygen atom that is incorporated into the solid. As a function of the degree of reduction, as I said, that is 0.5, essentially the catalyst is all vanadium 4 plus. What is shown here are four different samples of four different loadings of vanadium. The cross right here is a very low loading, and this other cross on the sideways is a sample that's close to a 1 monolayer coverage of vanadium equivalent. The four samples that we studied here have been broken down into two groups. The group with a square and this cross, they are the ones that have more than half a monolayer of vanadium on alumina. And the reoxidation heat starts off at somewhere around 180, 175 kilojoules per mole, and it decreases quite rapidly as we reoxidize the catalyst comes around 90-95 kJ per mole. The other problem are the lower loading samples. When they start off with a higher heat of reoxidation at around 200 kJ per mole. And that number also decreases, but it continues to be at a higher value than the higher loading samples. In essence, we are saying then that it's more difficult to reoxidize primary phase. It's more difficult to reduce the low loading sample than the high loading sample, because the tendency for the low loading sample thermodynamically to take up oxygen is stronger than the higher loading sample. In addition to the differences in this heat, we also found that the kinetics are different. It's kinetically, although more favorable to reoxidize the low loading sample, it's slower. Kinetically slower. Let me follow up on this kinetics question a little bit more by looking at one particular sample, let's say the square one. In this particular experiment, we started off with a position here. We oxidize it by putting in doses. The reason why we stop the reaction at this point, or this measurement at this point, is because the reoxidation rate becomes very slow. Over half an hour of our reoxidation, very little oxygen is being uptake. So what we did is as follows. This is the square that we had in the last slide, and this is exactly the same data point that I showed you earlier. Those experiments were done at 300 degrees. At this point, we heat up the sample to a high temperature of 500 degrees, and then repeat the experiment or continue the experiment by exposing more oxygen to the sample. We find out that then now the sample could continue to pick up oxygen. In fact, by continuing the experiment, we can have it essentially completely oxidized. It becomes a question to us. What is the nature that causes the slow kinetics at this point? There are two possible reasons. One is that there are no sites available for the reaction. And that is, we have to heat up the samples from 300 to 500 degrees to regenerate some of the sites for it to pick up oxygen. The other possibility, of course, is a simple kinetic factor. The sites are available, but the activation energy for reoxidation at this point becomes so high that we need higher temperature for the to do so. But to distinguish these two possibilities, one can do the following experiment. We can take the sample at this point where there's no uptake of oxygen. We heat it up to 500 degrees without exposure to oxygen, cool it back down to 300 degrees, and then expose oxygen to the sample again. If it is due to a kinetics, that is, when it requires high temperature to overcome the activation energy, by doing this cycle at this point to 500 degrees and then cool it back down to 300, we should not change the curve. There is still no more uptake of oxygen at 300 degrees. On the other hand, if it's due to regeneration of some of the active sites for uptake of oxygen, by so doing, maybe we can then regenerate some of the sites and we could be able to then pick up some oxygen again for the sample. And this experiment is done, and this is shown here. Again, this is the data you've been seeing. At this point, at the end of the 300 degree type of reoxidation, we heat up the sample to 500 degrees, cool it back down to 300 degrees, expose it to oxygen again. And we found out then that the sample can now pick up oxygen that they otherwise would not. However, it would not pick up oxygen all the way to fully oxidation, full oxidation. The kinetics is such that it would slow down rapidly after a few doses, and we could not continue the experiment anymore unless we heat it up to 300-500 degrees again. Well, one way to interpret this kinetic result is shown here. Although we might have started off our sample with a so-called monolayer of very well dispersed vanadium on the support alumina, upon reduction, we actually form a cluster of it, maybe a crystallite of this type. At 300 degrees, exposure to oxygen could only reoxidize an outer shell of the vanadium. Heating this sample up to 500 degrees would redistribute the oxygen. Perhaps it's simply a kinetics effect of lattice diffusion, allowing the high concentration of oxygen on the surface to diffuse into the bulk. thereby opening up some reduced site of the surface that will allow us to reoxidize even at 300 degrees again. But even at 300, if you do that at 300 degrees, the reoxidation again is confined only to the outer shell of the sample. If we continue the experiment at 500 degrees, the diffusion is rapid, as well as the reoxidation takes place readily, and we can fully reoxidize the sample. This type of model of changing from a wetted surface to a clustered type of vanadium oxide has been also proposed recently by Haber in Poland. Now, data essentially supports their model in this aspect. Let me now return to the oxidative dehydrogenation reaction. I left at that point to talk about this diversion when we were looking at the oxidative dehydrogenation of butane on the orthovanadate type of catalyst. We have to look at other butane as well on this vanadium magnesium oxide, and the active phase of this, as you may recall, is the magnesium orthovanadate. We have looked at other samples, alkanes, including propane, isobutane, butane, and cyclohexane. And what is shown here is selectivity for dehydrogenation for these compounds versus the conversion. The dehydrogenation selectivity for cyclohexane from cyclohexene and benzene is quite high. That's not too surprising. Benzene is a very stable product. For butane to butene butadiene is shown here. If you only look at the alkenes alone, which are the cyclohexene, butene, propene, and isobutene, the dependence of selectivity on conversion seem to follow a broad range in this particular area. If we report this data in a different form, we saw something rather surprising. What I've shown here is to plot the rate of consumption of oxygen versus the rate of consumption of hydrocarbon for all the data that I've shown you in the last slide. And what we found that there seems to fall on a curve that's common to all of these different hydrocarbons. What is surprising to us is that we're talking about very different types of reactions here, essentially. Well, let's say in the case of ethane, most of the products are combustion products. Whereas in the case of cyclohexane, most of the products are dehydrogenation products. Yet, the rate of consumption of oxygen versus the rate of consumption of hydrocarbons seems to follow a similar curve. Mind you that the slope of this curve essentially is the overall stoichiometry of the reaction. That is, the slope is the mole of oxygen consumed per mole of hydrocarbon. And this number, this stoichiometry, can change substantially depending on the reaction. For example, here's some of the numbers. If you look at the reaction of ethane, if it's truly 100% selective in dehydrogenation, this ratio should be only 0.5, or the slope in the last part will be 0.5. Whereas it's totally combustion, the slope will be 3.5, and so on for propane. For butane, for example, there are a number of selective reactions. For dehydrogenation to the alkene, it's 0.5. For the formation of maleic anhydride, it will be 3.5. For conversion, it's 6.5. And also in the case of pentane, one can dehydrogenate it to have a slope of 0.5. Formation of from pentane to maleic anhydride, in this case, the slope will be roughly 4.25. For the formation of pentane, for the formation of phthalate anhydride from pentane, the slope is 4.25. For the formation of maleic anhydride from pentane, the slope will be 5, and so on and so forth. In essence, although the slope that one could see in the plot that I just showed you, eventually from 0.5 to 9, we only see a rather constant number for all of these compounds. Now, having the same slope does not mean that they have the same selectivity. I showed you already, but let me just reiterate the point. If you look at, let's say, the reaction of propane, if I If one observes the slope in the plot of 1.4, there are at least two different combinations. In fact, there are infinite number of combinations one can obtain this slope of 1.4, the group of all spiral geometry of 1.4. One of them would be, for example, having a selectivity of about 70% in the hydroordination, and the other would be 80% in the hydroordination. And the difference is in whether the oxygen is consumed as CO or CO2. Now for different compounds, again, the same slope might mean very different selectivity. In the case of propylene, again, one could have a slope of 3.9 if I mix so much acetic acid that the rest is combustion. Whereas for the case of butane, for the same slope of 3.9, one would have quite selective production of maleic anhydride. So what I'm trying to say is that the same slope that I show you in that particular plot does not imply the same selectivity. Rather, it must mean something to do with the interaction of the alkanes with this active site of the catalyst, such that each time an alkane sits on the surface, you pick up the same number of oxygen. And to balance that, what we see is that the different CO to CO2 ratio, as well as different selectivity in the selective oxidation products. Now that does not mean that all the catalysts that we have studied only show one common line on that plot. Here's another example where we look at the vanadium phosphorus oxide. Now this is a catalyst that is currently used in the production of maleic anhydride from butane, the commercial catalyst. What we are looking at here now is the same type of plot, plotting the rate of oxygen consumption versus the rate of hydrocarbon consumption for three different molecules, ethane, propane, and butane. What we found is then that for C3 and C4, propane and butane, the consumption curve follow a particular trend, whereas for ethane, it goes to a different trend by itself. You may also see that the curve is not a straight line. That is not expected because as one increases the conversion, we would get lower and lower selectivity. In essence, this curve would approach closer and closer to the curve where we have total combustion. It's relatively easy for us to look at the initial slope for, let's say, the C3 and the C4, but in the case of C2, we are a little bit unclear exactly what the slope should be. If you look at that, most of the data is our major portion of the data. The slope of this plot would be 2, whereas if you look at the initial 3 points, the slope is closer to 1.2. We are going to do more work to clarify that point. But nonetheless, let me summarize to you what the slopes of these plots are for the different compounds, as well as the different catalysts that we've studied. And that's shown in this slide. For the vanadium magnesium oxide catalyst, the one that I showed earlier, all the slopes is close to 2, the slopes are close to 2, maybe this one is a little bit higher, but again, this may be simply a fact that we need to look at the more data point extrapolating it closer to the volume. Another catalyst I show you is this vanadium phosphorus oxide. For this particular catalyst, we study the reactions close to 300 to 350 degrees Celsius. Whereas for this vanadium magnesium oxide, we're talking about a reaction temperature close to 500 degrees. This is the slope for ethane, and the initial point is, let's say, close to 1.5, whereas for C3 and C4, the slope is again close to 4. For the magnesium pyrovanadate, another catalyst that we've studied, we found that again we get two different lines, like the case of vanadium phosphorus oxide, and the slopes are either 2 or 4. Well, although it might be a little bit too early to tell, but perhaps we can be brave and say that based on what we have seen so far, the oxidation reaction on these samples seem to follow the consumption of oxygen to hydrocarbon ratio of either 2 or something close to 4. Right? If you extrapolate or try to postulate a little further, and try to understand why is it that we only see one slope here, whereas if we see two different slopes there, we would then try to attribute this to the different active sites that are available to different these catalysts. On the magnesium orthobenedite, I showed you the structure of it, and I said that there is no magnesium oxygen vanadium bridging bonds. Right? I should say there's no vanadium oxygen vanadium bridging bonds, and all the bonds are magnesium oxygen vanadium bonds. That's one way to look at it. Another way to look at it is that all the vanadium O4 units are isolated from each other. Whereas in the case of B207 and the vanadium pyrophosphate, and one way to look at the structure is that they are composed of B207 units. And the B207 units is essentially two VO4 units that share corners. And maybe the fact that you have two such tetrahedra sharing corner permits the sample, the surface intermediate to pick up twice as many number of oxygen as, let's say, in the case of isolated VO4 units. This is just a postulate. We would like to understand this further in the future. Although the ratio of oxygen to hydrocarbon is 2, for let's say C3 here, C3 here, and C2 there, let me call that close to 2 at this moment. And I want to emphasize again, that doesn't mean that they have the same selectivity necessarily. However, in this particular case, in this particular three samples, the selectivity seem to be quite similar to each other. As shown in this slide, we're talking now about the dehydrogenation selectivity versus conversion for propane on magnesium orthobenedite, propane on magnesium pyrobenedite, and ethane on BPO. And they seem to follow each other relatively well in this plot. And that's surprising to us because vanadium pyrophosphate, as you might remember, is a very good catalyst for making maleic anhydride. In essence, it's a catalyst that can insert oxygen to the hydrocarbon. In fact, when we study the propane of this vanadium pyrophosphate, most of the reaction is simply combustion, very little selective dehydrogenation or oxidation reactions. For some reasons, for ethane, this seems to be a rather selective catalyst, as selective as anything in terms of oxidative dehydrogenation at these low temperatures as anything we have seen. Well, let me summarize that at this point what I've said so far. In terms of selectivity in alkene oxidation, we've shown that the selectivity depends on the structural properties of the oxide. It is influenced by the reducibility of the cation at the active site. It's a very specific function of the molecule. It differs from C2 to C3 to C4, as well as on the oxide itself, for that matter. And there seems to exist some specific relationship between the rate of oxygen and the rate of hydrocarbon consumption. A point that perhaps when we look at it as, instead of looking at the selectivity from the point of view of the hydrocarbon, when we look at the efficiency in terms of oxygen consumption and classify catalysts that way. I'd like to explore a little further about these specific relationships, not in terms of understanding it further, but in terms of what's the consequence of it to the kinetics of oxidation. And that leads me to the last part of the talk, which I'll be talking about as an example, something other than oxidative dehydrogenation. when we were trying to understand this particular relationship between oxygen consumption and hydrocarbon consumption, we ran across this piece of data that's published in 1980 by George Kells and co-workers on propane oxidation to acrylate over bismuth monoxide. What they group have found is that if I plot the log of the rate of the reaction, which is the consumption of propene, which is one of the temperature in the immediate plot, there are two kinetic regions shown here, the high temperature and the low temperature regions. In the high temperature region, the rate of reaction is first order in the hydrocarbon, and when we substitute the propane with butyropropane, propene with butyropropane, there's no change in the observed selectivity or little change. And there is an observed kinetic isotope effect. The protonated the hydrogen propene and the butyropropane differ in the rates by about a factor of 2. In the low temperature region, the kinetics is such that it depends on the partial pressure of oxygen, not on the alkenes. The selectivity depends on whether it's deuterated or not deuterated protein. And the deuterated protein is low in selectivity for ethylene formation. There is also an observed isotope effect depending on the catalyst. And the range is at from about 1.2 to 2. The way that that this author is trying to explain the kinetics of this is as shown in the following. But what I think to remember for the remaining part is for these two points at the bottom here. At the low temperature region, the selectivity using deuterated protein is lower, as well as the observation of a kinetic isotope effect. What they have proposed in explaining the kinetics is as follows. There are two types of sites on the bismuth molecule, a so-called oxidized site and a reduced site. On the oxidized site, protein would absorb. It will react by picking up oxygen and react with the solid to form acrolein. And the site then becomes reduced, which can be reoxidized by reaction with oxygen. Writing a kinetic equation for each of the steps and for each of the sites, the arranging them, they all arrive at this overall reaction rate expression, in which the rate of consumption of T depends on the partial pressure of oxygen times the rate constant for the reoxidation, which is this term here, divided by this term over here, which depends on the rate constant for the reaction of alkene with the active site. The assumption, of course, is that when the alkene absorbs and reacts, it reduces the site, so there's the K of reduction here. By taking two different limits for high temperature and low temperature, one finds that at high temperature limit, where the reoxidation is much faster than the reactive absorption of the alkene, the rate would become dependent on only the partial pressure of alkene, and the absorbed rate constant will be the rate constant for the reactive absorption of alkene. Whatever, it will not be surprising that when we observe the deuterium kinetic isotope effect. At the low temperature region, which is the region where the reoxidation of the catalyst becomes slow compared to the reactive absorption, and this kinetic expression could be reduced to this simple form, where the rate would be a function of only the partial pressure of the oxygen as observed, and the observed rate constant would be the rate constant for reoxidation. Now, it is then becomes surprising why, if the observed rate constant is indeed the measure of the rate constant of the oxidation reaction, would it depend on whether it's a deuterium isotope or hydrocarbon or not? There is, one would expect that there would be no deuterium kinetic isotope effect. To try to explain this particular fact, we like to propose a more detailed model of what might happen on the catalyst. In essence, we said that in addition to having an oxidized site where hydrocarbon A or alkene would absorb, and a reduced site SR, which can be reoxidized by reaction of oxygen to form the oxidized site, we have also to take into account of the sites that are covered by the reactant intermediates, so-called I. Let me run through this for you for a moment. This is the reaction sequence. We have an oxidized site on which the hydrocarbon absorbs. It absorbs to form an intermediate called I in a general sense. And the site now, I will label it as a surface site as copper, but it's still in an oxidized form, so it's SCO. This intermediate will react by picking up an oxygen to form an intermediate called IO. In so doing, the site is reduced, so it becomes surface copper reduced site. And it's labeled 1, subscript 1, because now the intermediate that sits on it has 1 oxygen. This site cannot react further. In order for it to react further, it has to pick up an oxygen by diffusion of an oxygen from an oxidized site in the neighborhood, diffusion of the lattice oxygen to this reduced site to form now a copper oxidized site that has an intermediate that contains 1 oxygen. This intermediate now can pick up another oxygen to form now IO2, and the site is reduced. It can be reoxidized by lattice diffusion again. Then the intermediate can be further oxidized to form another intermediate, and so on and so forth. Until you pick up enough number of oxygen atoms to form the product P with atom bond. Well, but that's only most of the picture. To complete the picture, we will have to allow not only diffusion of lattice oxygen from the oxidized site to this covered reduced site, we will have also to allow the diffusion of this oxidized covered site to a reduced site, jumping out to reoxidize this SR site by lattice diffusion. All that we have to do then is to write kinetic equations of all of these steps. But to summarize it a little bit, let me just show it in a simplified form. In essence, we are saying that there are four different types of sites. An oxidized site that could absorb the reactant. The reduced site, which can be reoxidized to form the oxidized site by picking up a reaction left and with a gaseous oxygen. But at some intermediate, we stay on a surface site by picking up oxygen one at a time. In so doing, the copper site would convert from an oxidized form to a reduced form, and the reduced form is reoxidized to the oxidized form by lattice diffusion. And the oxidized form can also be reduced without reaction with the intermediate by diffusion to the reduced form. So the kinetic equations now include the surface reaction, which can be represented by Ks, reactions with the reactant Ka, reaction of the reduced site with oxygen, K reoxidation, and also the diffusion, which is represented by the jumping of lattice oxygen from one site to another. This is a summary of the equations that we have to worry about. So there are four different types of sites: oxidized site, reduced site, copper site that are both in the oxidized form and the reduced form, summing them up to one. If we assume irreversible reactions, then the observed rate of reaction will be simply the rate constant for the reactant absorption times the partial pressure times the surface cut ratio of this oxidized site. It's also equal to each of the steps on the surface. The new equation that we introduced for this kinetics is the number three here. We say that for the intermediate to pick up a total of n plus one lattice oxygen, it can do so in the following manner. This number of lattice oxygen is equal to the number that the molecule pick up on absorption, which is m, a fixed number, plus the number of oxygen that is diffused through the site while the intermediate sits on it, minus the number of oxygen that diffuses away from the site while the intermediate sits on it. In essence, this difference between these two last terms is the net number of oxygen that is oxygen diffused through this active site while the intermediate is sitting on the surface. So that term depends on the surface resistance height of the intermediate car times the jump frequency J times R is the fraction of time that the site is in the oxidized form, and 1 minus R is, R is when the oxidized site is in the reduced form, and 1 minus R is when the site is in the oxidized form. To emphasize this term for lattice diffusion, we can rearrange the equation to say T, which is essentially a measure of the number of oxygen atoms that the intermediate makes up while it is in, sitting on the surface, and say that is equal to these last two terms that we talked about. And since tau, the surface residence time, is 1 over the rate constant for the surface reaction, I can rearrange this equation to read the following. Finally, you write the equation for the surface size and set a steady state swapping point for, let's say in this case, the oxidized site, and put it into the rate equation of this form, and we get an equation of as shown here. Well, let's look at the two temperature region again. At high temperature, which we're talking about reoxidation being very fast comparing to the reactive absorption of the hydrocarbon, then the observed rate of this scheme will be equal to the Ka times Pa. Ka is the constant for the reactive absorption of the alkane, or alkene. That is exactly the form that is identical to the earlier model, the more simple model. In the low temperature scheme, in the low temperature regime, we're talking about reoxidation of the surface of the reduced surface in the slow step. In that case, this model would result in the observed reaction rate then equal to K oxidation, reconstant oxidation, times the partial pressure of oxygen, which this term is identical to the earlier model also, but now it's being modified by this term 1 plus T, where T, if you recall, is the number, is related to the number of oxygen atoms picked up by the molecule on the average while it's in resonance on the surface. In essence, the larger the number for T, the larger is the number of oxygen atoms that the molecule pick up, or the lower is the selectivity for dehydrogenation. The largest value for T is when the intermediate ones carbon dioxide totally. Now let's look at what happens if we replace, if you look at the kinetic isotope effect in this low temperature regime. We are comparing then the observed rate when the alkene is in the hydrogen form versus in the deuterium form. So the oxidation rate constant is independent of hydrocarbon, so that should not depend on whether it's deuterated or not. That is the partial pressure of oxygen. The only thing that depends on it, perhaps, is that T, the number of oxygen taken up by the deuterated hydrocarbon, or the plutonic hydrocarbon. So that's the term here. And we can show that this ratio of the rates will be larger than 1 for an observation of the normal kinetic isotope effect if TD is larger than TH, or, in other words, if the deuterated molecule shows a lower selectivity, one would observe an apparent kinetic isotope effect, although the actual rate, the slow step, is by the oxidation of the hydrocarbon of the catalyst. And one can even observe an inverse kinetic isotope effect if the deuterated molecule cannot be more selective in oxidation. Well, let me now summarize what I just said in the kinetics here. We say that in under certain circumstances, even if the rate is limited by the supply of oxygen or reoxidation of the catalyst, a change in the stoichiometry, as reflected by change in the observed selectivity, would affect the surface residence time, and that's all, and therefore the turnover frequency, which is then could show as an apparent kinetic isotope effect. Which means then that if we simply look at the kinetic isotope effect as the indication for whether the stage one breaking is a radiant thing or not, one has to be careful and make sure that we are not working under this particular reoxidation limited regime. Well, let me then summarize the talk that I've just given. We have shown you that the oxidative deoxygenation of alkene of vanadate depends on the selectivity of the reaction, depends on the reducibility of the metal cation in the solid. It's also a function of the molecule as well as the structure of the oxide. In terms of this particular relationship, we found that there is and yet not fully understood a special relationship between the rate of consumption of oxygen and rate of consumption of hydrocarbon. Perhaps one way to look at that is to look at the so-called efficiency in terms of the oxygen consumption. We have shown you that on supported vanadium oxide, in the particular case of support using alumina, the heat of reoxidation of partially reduced vanadium is a strong function of the degree of reduction as well as the loading. It's a stronger function of reduction. The heat could range from anywhere from about 200 kilojoules per mole of oxygen down to as low as 50 kilojoules per mole of oxygen. We also show then that the evidence using our work in support of others that the reduced vanadium species we arrange can most likely migrate upon reduction and reoxidation. And finally, I've shown you that an observed kinetic isotope effect may indeed indicate stage one breaking with the radiating step, but it may not. It could, under certain conditions, especially when reoxidation is a slow and there's a change in selectivity, then there is no relationship between the stage one breaking rate constant and the rate constant in the observed kinetics. Thank you for your attention.